All. Today's topic of discussion is common pediatric fractures. The anatomy and biomechanics of pediatric bone differs from that of adult bone, leading to unique pediatric fracture patterns, healing mechanisms, and management. In comparison to adult bone, pediatric bone is less dense, more porous, and penetrated throughout by capillary channels. Also, pediatric periosteum is extremely strong and thick, functioning in reduction and maintenance of fracture alignment and healing. Anatomy of pediatric bone. Basically, there are three type of three regions in a pediatric bone which are essential to know. First is epiphysis, physis, and third is metaphysis. Epiphysis, each end of a long bone with associated joint cartilage. Physis is also known as growth plate, where the cartilage cells create solid bone with growth. Metaphysis is wide area just below the physis, and it is closest to the diaphysis and shaft. This is a radiograph which shows radius. It's a wrist radiograph where we see the normal parts of a growing bone. Here we can see carpal bone. This is distal radius and ulna. In radius, this is epiphysis, and this thin lucent line, this is a physis or also known as growth plate, followed by metaphysis, which is a wider zone, and then diaphysis or shaft of the long bone. This is a normal growing bone, how it grows. Now, how do the pediatric bones are pediatric fractures are different from adults? Because in pediatric bones, ends of the long bones have thick cartilage, so they are not seen on x-rays. Thick periosteum, so there is good blood supply, and it results in good healing. Thirdly, the pediatric bones are more elastic and more cancellous, so most of the fractures are incomplete or also known as simple fractures. And because of the growth plate in the pediatric bones at the end of the bone, there is good remodeling, and growth plate injuries, if occur, that can cause deformity of the long bones. Now, what are the fractures which are peculiar to the children or commonly occurs in the children? They are classified as torus or buckling fracture, green stick fracture, Boeing fracture, and epiphyseal fractures. These are the diagrammatic representation of the torus, green stick, Boeing, and epiphyseal fracture, which I'll be describing in details. Okay. First, let's describe torus or buccal fracture. These are the incomplete fractures of the shaft of a long bone, which is characterized by bulging of the cortex. Commonly, it occurs at distal radius or tibia following a fall on an outstretched arm, and the common age group is 5 to 10 years. On the radiograph, what we see is there is subtle deformity or buckle of the cortex, but there is no distinct fracture line. I'll show you the example. Here, this is the example of torus fracture of a radius. This is a child who met with an ATV accident, and on AP radiograph, you see there is a subtle buckling of the cortex of the distal radius. There is no distinct fracture line on this radiograph, but if we see the lateral projection, on lateral projection, there is a buckle-like deformity here. So this is a torus or buckle fracture of the distal radius. Next is green stick fracture. Green stick fracture is a transverse fracture of the cortex, which extends into the mid portion of the bone and becomes oriented along the longitudinal axis without disrupting the opposite cortex. It commonly occurs in less than 10 years of age, and fractures are commonly mid-diaphyseal, and it affects the forearm and lower legs. Here we have this radiograph where we see again the distal radius and ulna fractures. Ulna is not involved here in this case. This is a typical of green stick fracture where we see a transverse fracture which is involving one of the cortex and the other cortex is not involved. On lateral projection, you can see very clearly this is a green stick fracture. Now, next is Boeing fracture or deformation. Deformation or bowing of the bone due to a longitudinal stress in comparison to the normal side. Almost exclusively in children, age group of 2 to 5 years, and commonly in the forearm involving radius or ulna. Again, there is absence of visible cortical injury, and they usually heal by remodeling, and therefore no intervention is needed in these cases. Again, we have forearm bone radiograph where we see radius and ulna. Here there is excessive bowing of the ulna compared to the normal side. This is the normal side, and if we compare, there is excessive bowing of the ulna, so it's a bowing fracture of the ulna. These fractures normally heal. These fractures normally heal themselves, and to identify these kind of fractures, we normally need the comparison view of the normal side to identify. This is a radiograph where we see bowing fracture as well as buccal fracture. So in this case, there is bowing fracture of the right fibula and buccal fracture of the tibia, distal tibia. This arrow shows the slight bowing of the fibula compared to the normal side. This is a normal side. We can see the straight cortex of the fibula on the other side. But here there is some deformity, bowing deformity. So this is bowing fracture of the distal fibula. And on the tibia, if you see in the lateral cortex, there is some buckling. So this is a buccal fracture of the distal tibia. So both fractures are seen on the, both patterns are seen on the same radiograph. Next, which is very important injury in pediatric patients, that is epiphyseal injury. Epiphyseal injury occurs in 35% of 35% of skeletal injuries. That is epiphyseal injury, and epiphyseal plate fractures are common in 10 to 15 years of age group. The identification is important because it can result in premature closure, limb shortening, and abnormal growth of the bones. For epiphyseal injury, there is a classification which is also known as Salter-Harris classification. This is a diagrammatic representation of Salter-Harris classification of epiphyseal injuries. In this, most common type is type 2, which occurs in 75% of pediatric population. This is epiphyseal first type 1, where the fracture occurs through the growth plate. Transverse fracture occurs through the growth plate. And it is also called as epiphyseal slip, and the prognosis is quite favorable in these cases. This is type 1 injury. Then second type 2 is where the fracture occurs through the epiphyseal plate with triangle of the shaft attached, or a metaphysis is also involved. Type 3 is fracture through the epiphysis extending into the epiphyseal plate, but the metaphysis is spared in these cases. Type 3 and type 4, both are intra-articular fractures where the prognosis is not very good, and it can result in chronic disability because both are kind of intra-articular fractures. In type 4, what we see, the fracture of the epiphysis and metaphysis and epiphyseal plate. So it involves three of them. It involves epiphysis, metaphysis, and growth plate. So type 4 and type 3 have bad prognosis. Type 5 is when there is a crush injury to the epiphyseal plate. So there is a damage of the epiphyseal plate. This also has poor prognosis. I'll show you the example. This is type 1 Salter-Harris fracture of the ankle, where this is an AP radiograph. On AP radiograph, it is not very evident. Sometimes to detect type 1 injury, one AP radiograph is not sufficient. You need multiple views to locate the injury. Here, there is a slight widening of the epiphyseal plate on AP radiograph, but when the lateral radiograph was performed, it showed slippage of the growth plate. We can see widening as well as slippage. So this is a type 1 Salter-Harris fracture. This is example of type 2 fracture. This is Salter 2 fracture of the proximal phalanx of the thumb. Here we can see that it involves the growth plate and metaphysis, but epiphysis is spared. Here we see some callus formation because the fracture is a little old. Type 3 fracture. This is a type 3 fracture involving the ankle. On both radiographs, AP and lateral radiographs, we see a fracture line which is traversing the, which is involving the growth plate and epiphysis, but metaphysis is spared in this case. On both AP and lateral projections, we see line involving these two structures, but metaphysis is spared. So this is type 3 epiphyseal injury. Type 4 fracture. Here, all this, there's a line we can see very clearly. This line is involving the metaphyseal shaft, growth plate, as well as epiphysis. Because it involves epiphysis, so articular cartilage is also involved, so it's a kind of intra-articular fracture. So this can lead to chronic disability, type 4 fracture. Now, what are the complications of physial fractures? Physial fracture can lead to malunion, infection, neurovascular problems, osteonecrosis, or growth disturbance. Till now, what we have discussed, most of them were incomplete fractures in the pediatric patients, but complete fractures can also occur in pediatric bones. So fracture which completely propagates through the bone, which runs from one cortex to another, that is called as complete fracture. It can be classified as spiral, transverse, or oblique depending upon the direction of the fracture line. For example, this is a femoral radiograph, femoral radiograph. What we see, there's a transverse fracture running through the mid shaft of the femur. And another example of complete fracture is distal tibia fracture. This is a kind of oblique fracture. It is also complete fracture. Here the ulna is not involved, only the isolated tibial fracture is there. Oblique fracture of the, and slightly displaced fracture of the distal tibia shaft. Now, depending upon the anatomical location, what are the common fractures which we see in pediatric patients? First, let's start from the clavicle. Clavicle we will discuss. Distal radius V and ulna forearm fracture we have already discussed. And third, the important region is elbow. In elbow, more than 60% of all elbow fractures in children are supracondylar fractures, and 90% are because of hyperextension injury due to fall on an outstretched hand. So the most common in elbow is supracondylar fracture, followed by lateral condyle fractures. Lateral condyle fractures comprise 10 to 20% of the elbow fractures. Let's start with clavicle. In clavicle, mostly the middle third of the clavicle is involved in 80% of cases. In 15% cases, distal third, and in 5% proximal third. Common injury pattern are birth injury is common. It can lead to clavicular fracture, and second is fall on an outstretched hand. Clavicle fractures, non-displaced or displaced, usually is very conservatively. Here, this is an example of clavicular fracture. The most common site of the occurrence is middle third of the clavicle. Here, there is a kind of deformity, bowing deformity, or we can say there is a fracture which is not very clearly seen, but it is deformed in the middle third. It's a middle third clavicular fracture. Now, before going in detail about the elbow fractures, let's discuss about the few X-ray lines which are important to rule out fracture as well as dislocation in elbow joint. These two lines are anterior humeral line and radiocapitular line. Anterior humeral line is a line drawn on a lateral view along the anterior surface of the humerus, which should pass through the middle third of the capitulum. Here, this is a normal radiograph. We can see this is a true lateral projection, and a line is drawn along the anterior surface of the humerus. It is passing through the middle third of the capitulum. Similarly, here there is little projection is little not entirely true, but still it is passing through the middle third of the capitulum. Now, this is abnormal. Line is not passing through the so this radiograph, posterior fat pad. Here we can see this fat lucency. This fat lucency posterior fat pad, which I'll discuss later in detail. So here, in this patient where I'm saying there is abnormal radiograph, there was a supracondylar fracture. We can very clearly see there is thin line here. So this is an example of supracondylar fracture where the anterior humeral line is not bisecting the middle third of the capitulum. Next line is radiocapitular line. This line is drawn through the center of the radial neck. It should pass through the center of the capitulum. In dislocation of the radius, this line will not pass through the center of the capitulum. So this is a normal radiograph where we see this line. It is through the radial neck, through the radius, and it is entering into the, it is going through the center of the capitulum. These are the normal radiographs. Here some projection is little different view, but still it is going through the center of the capitulum. But this is abnormal where there is a fracture, and you can see that it is going through the anterior aspect of the capitulum. It is not going through the center of the capitulum. Another example, this is another patient where we see fracture dislocation, radial fracture as well as dislocation. So here it's not going, it's going in front of the capitulum. So this is, so in these patient, in this patient, these two lines are quite helpful. Let's discuss about supracondylar fracture. As I already told you, that this is AP and lateral projection. In the true lateral projection, we can very clearly see the posterior fat pad sign. We can see the lucency posteriorly, and there is a lucency anteriorly which is elevated. And this is a fracture. This is a fracture which is very clearly seen on AP radiograph. Zoomed image of fat pad sign. This is when there is a distension of the joint fluid, then the anterior fat pad, it becomes elevated. So this is anterior fat pad which is normally not elevated. Here it is elevated, and posterior fat pad is normally not seen. When it is visible, this means that there is some occult fracture. Then we have to search for a fracture. So this is known as posterior positive fat pad sign. What is the classification of supracondylar fracture? Classification of supracondylar fracture is known as Gartland classification. More than 60% of all elbow fractures in children are supracondylar fractures, and the injury, as we have already discussed, is hyperextension type, and normally patient falls on an outstretched hand. This is a Gartland classification, type 1, type 2, type 3, and here this is the radiographic representation of this injury. In type 1, it's a non-displaced injury, and the normally it is green stick or torus type of fracture. And type 2 is when the fracture is there but posterior cortex is intact. So this is type 2, and type 3 when there is fracture, dislocation, completely displaced fracture of the humerus. This is known as type 3 supracondylar fracture. In type 3 fracture, there are chances of neurovascular compromise and chronic deformity. Next is lateral condyle fracture. It is the second most common distal humeral fracture and physial injury to the elbow. It occurs between the age of 4 to 10 years. On this is an AP radiograph where we can clearly see the displaced fracture of the lateral condyle, and here there is an associated soft tissue hematoma. Another example where we see that metaphyseal fracture fragment because of the, and we can see a lucency shown by yellow arrow, and trochlear surface of the humerus is also involved in this case. In lower leg fracture, tibia and fibula fractures often occur together, but isolated tibial fractures are also seen. So basically, if we see tibial fracture, always look for a fibula fracture also. Fibula fracture could be just a plastic deformity. Mechanism is fall and twisting injury of the foot, as the, normally these are low force and intact periosteum, and support from fibula can prevent displacement commonly. This is a very typical fracture of the distal tibia, which is also known as toddler's fracture. In this, child usually becomes irritable and refuses to weight bear and refuses to walk. And toddler fracture is normally undisplaced fracture, minimally or undisplaced fracture, which is commonly seen on which is commonly seen in the distal tibia, and usually of distal tibia, typically seen in toddlers and occurs in age group of 9 months and 3 years of age. Sometimes it is not seen on one radiograph, one view. We need to have multiple views to detect toddler fracture. Here in this case, we are seeing a linear lucency which is undisplaced, but sometimes we don't see a lucency, we just see sclerosis. So that also indicates that can also be the another presentation of toddler fracture. Tibial, another common injury in children is tibial tuberosity apophysis avulsion fracture. This is a lateral radiograph. Mechanism is jump or landing where quadriceps contraction pulls off the tubercle as the knee flexes. Here there is a line involving the apophysis of the tibia, proximal tibia. So it is a tibial tuberosity apophysis fracture. As I was discussing earlier, that tibial fractures can also occur isolatedly. It's not always that fibula is involved, but if you see tibial fracture, we should also look for fibula fracture. But this is an example where tibia is only involved. So this is the AP radiograph where we see displaced oblique fracture of the mid tibial shaft, and fibula is intact in this case. Important hip abnormality or hip fracture which I wanted to discuss is slipped capital femoral apophysis. It is a common condition which affects the physis of the proximal femur in adolescent age group. Commonest hip abnormality, and normally bilateral in 20% of cases. It is a kind of type 1 Salter-Harris growth plate injury. Here on radiograph, there is displacement of the femoral head posteromedially, and which is difficult to see on AP film. Findings on AP film can include asymmetric physial widening or indistinct metaphyseal border at the level of the physis. Frog-like lateral views are essential for the diagnosis, as minimal slippage can be better appreciated on frog-like lateral views. Here we have an example of slipped capital femoral apophysis. This is a normal AP radiograph. What we see is subtle sclerosis of the metaphysis of the femoral neck. In the femoral neck, we see just subtle sclerosis is here. But apophysis injury is not very well appreciable. But when the lateral projection was done, what we see is there is displacement of the femoral head in comparison to the femoral neck. It is displaced medially and posteriorly. So this was classic appearance. This is a classic appearance for slipped capital femoral apophysis. Few words about non-accidental trauma, which is important to diagnose for a radiologist. For this, the clinical history is very important. 1 to 1.5% of all children are abused each year. High percentage of fractures in less than 3 years is because of non-accidental trauma. Greater risk of abuse are firstborn, premature infants, stepchildren, children with physical disability. And in non-accidental trauma, after the skin lesions like bruises, fractures are the second most common physical presentation. Bones that fractures commonly are femur, humerus, tibia, radius, skull, spine, posterior ribs, ulna, fibula, and they have some specific pattern of injuries which can make you. Then skeletal survey should be considered. In those children, findings are unexplained fractures in different stages of healing, femoral fracture in a child less than 1 year of age, scapular fracture in a child without a clear history of violent trauma, apophyseal and metaphyseal fractures of the long bones, corner or chip fractures of the metaphysis, which is very typical, and buccal handle fractures, metaphyseal fracture fragment which is seen as a disc or buccal handle at the distal end of the bone. Here we have examples. This is a radiograph of a knee joint. You see there is a metaphyseal fracture or corner, also known as chip fracture, of the distal femur, typical of non-accidental trauma, and then example of Buckert handle fracture, where we see metaphyseal fragment along the distal bone and it appears like a disc. Rib fractures on a chest radiograph, they are at the different stages of healing. Some are acute, some are subacute. In like here, the posterior ribs have some callus formation, so different stages of healing of the ribs, specifically the posterior ribs, lead to suspicion of non-accidental trauma. In long bones, femoral shaft fracture and humeral shaft fracture, they are suspicious for battered baby syndrome. Femoral shaft fracture, if occurs, if there is a transverse fracture and less than 1 year of age, then in 60 to 70%, this could be non-accidental. And humeral shaft fracture, long bones transverse fracture, can be result of non-accidental trauma, because spiral fractures or diaphyseal fractures in children are basically due to twisting mechanism. They are less commonly due to accident or other kind of trauma. These kind of injuries normally occur because of because of twisting injury. So we have to keep that in mind. With this, I'll finish my presentation. Thank you very much.